Are we live?
Yes. Hi, everybody. Thank you for joining our Madman live stream at Supernova in Melbourne. My name's Jess. I'm from Madman, and I'm joined today with the lovely, amazing Brina Palencia, who has
voiced... You said my name right.
Oh, yes.
Nailed it.
Who has voiced so many amazing voice... characters, sorry, not voice actors, that would be weird. So you've done Toriko from Tokyo Ghoul, CL from Black Butler, Tony Chopper from One Piece,
Jubia
from Fairy Tail, massive one.
Apollo from Spice and Wool.
Yes.
Mad Moxie in Borderlands.
Summer Wars.
Yeah, Natsuki in Summer Wars. I've done a lot of stuff.
Yeah. And they're all really huge roles. I mean, looking back at what you've done, it's really amazing. And and Yuno Gasai from The Future Diary.
Yeah.
How could we leave that out?
Yeah, there's a huge fan base for Yuno here, which, like,
there is
a pretty big one in the US, but I feel like it's even bigger here, which is kind of cool.
I feel that too. Have you seen any cosplayers walking
around? A ton of them.
Yeah.
I've seen a ton of them.
Super awesome. Popular. Yeah. We've had quite a lot of people message us about Yuno on the Facebook page.
Yeah, so I love it.
We absolutely had to bring her up. How has your trip to Australia been so far?
It's been really fantastic.
Yeah.
This is my second time in Australia. First time doing Gold Coast in Melbourne.
Yeah.
And I have to say, this is probably the most beautiful city I've ever been to. And I've done a lot of traveling, but I wish I was going to be here for another week. I'm leaving tomorrow morning, which totally sucks. Wow. But I love it here. I hope I get to come back.
What are some of the things you've done over here outside of Supernova?
I did a wine tour, which is cool. We've done a lot of exploring just around the city. Like, it's one of those cities that's just really fun. Like, I love all the alleyways and stuff that they have. It's just really fun.
Melbourne's really cool
I love it.
I'm originally from Perth, so...
Oh, okay.
I moved over here like a year ago, but yeah, that was something that
it's
I really loved
fun.
About
and there's like such an artistic culture. Like,
yeah.
I saw a bunch of really cool street performers last night. It's just really great. I really wish I had several, like at least a week more here.
And one of the questions we've had, because you also do not just anime voice acting, but you've done some other kind of roles such as Walking Dead and Star-Crossed?
Yes.
So because of the Walking Dead role, we were sort of wondering, how would you survive in a zombie apocalypse?
I actually have a few plans in place because I live in both Los Angeles and Dallas. I split my time between the two cities, so it depends on what city I would be in. It's kind of different for each one. I've actually had like sit down talks like with my husband about like if the apocalypse were to come, what would we do? And then also in LA, because it's actually kind of a legit fear, not necessarily zombies, but they have earthquakes and stuff. So there's like, there could actually be a catastrophic event where like I'm separated from people. So one of my best friends since high school, who's like family to me, lives out there. And like she has like a plan of like, okay, if this happens, what's a place, like a central location that we could try to get to so that we know that the other person's okay and so that we can team up and whatever. So there's that. And then like in Dallas, it's kind of a totally different thing. Because in Dallas, I live more in the city in an apartment. And so, which is honestly for
zombies. Is it high up? Would you be?
It's high up, yeah.
Okay.
Which is cool, but it's also still like if you're in the city, you're kind of screwed because there's a lot of people that would turn zombie at some point. So
be kind of isolated almost.
Yeah, exactly.
What about the food? How would you do it?
Well, I always have a ton of canned food, actually.
What kind of canned food?
Beans. I do a lot of beans.
Beans.
A lot of chickpeas. A lot of protein, you know?
Yeah.
I don't ever do a lot of canned vegetables just because they're gross. I love vegetables, but I like them fresh. And I've been wanting to do more planting, like gardening, like being able to garden. I also like to study like little, I even had a dream about it. I really want to study more about like medical stuff, like how do you do stitches and all that kind of stuff. I think it would be really cool.
It'd be such a useful skill. You'd be able to bring it out.
Yeah, right?
Like, not that it's a good thing that people are always in trouble, but
right.
Another thing we were wondering, because you've voiced Toko from Tokyo Ghoul, and we were wondering what it was like to get that role, and were you a fan of Tokyo Ghoul before you landed it?
No, I wasn't a fan before I landed it because I didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
But when I got it, I actually watched the whole series before recording, and I fell in love with it. And Toko was a very easy character for me to connect to, I think, if I were a flesh-eating ghoul. That's basically who I would be. To the point where my husband, whenever I was watching it, and I told him, like, oh, hey, I need to watch this show for research for a role that I'm doing in it. And he was like, oh, okay, whatever. And he kind of, like, came into the room at one point and just watched it for about a minute. And he was like, you the purple hair? And I was like, yeah. And he was like, that makes sense. That's right. Because she's just a very similar temperament.
Yeah, yeah. And with Sio from Black Butler, how did you practice the British accent?
I actually, Colleen Klinkenbeard was the one who cast me in that role, and she told me to watch Jane Austen movies, like Masterpiece Theater or whatever that the BBC put on. And so I watched, every morning before I would go into my sessions, I would wake up a couple hours early and like watch a movie and just repeat everything that I heard in the accent. And so that's kind of how I learned it.
Yeah. Have many people, since you've been over here, been talking about, because you also did the voice for Nina Tucker.
Yeah, that was my first featured character that I ever got.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Have you had many questions about that?
No, not really. For a while, that was, like, my most well-known character. Even after I had, like, several leads, like, people were still like, oh, my God, Nina Tucker. Like, people will bring it up and just be like, oh, wasn't that terribly sad? And it's just like, yeah, it was awful.
Because we had a fan question from The Office. They wanted to know, what was it like being turned into a dog by your dad in Fullmetal Alchemist?
The funny thing about it is that when I got the role, I was really, really excited because I thought that I had gotten the lead in the show, so I thought I was going to be, like, in the whole show. So I only did one session. It was, like, 4 hours. So, like, going in for the 4 hours and, like, by the end of it, you know, getting turned into the Chimera and just kind of like, oh, so am I done? They're like, yeah, that's all the character does. And I'm like, oh.
Did you have a similar reaction when you got cast as Rei Ayanami for Evangelion Rebuild?
And I knew that she didn't talk that much.
Yeah.
So I wasn't really expecting a lot. And I didn't know a whole lot about the character going into it, which I think was a blessing. Because Mike McFarlane, who was the director of that, like, tried to kind of warn me, like, hey, this is a really huge fan favorite and whatever, and I was like, okay, whatever, but there's no way to really gauge that until you experience it. And so I recorded it before they announced it, and which I'm really glad I did, because after they announced that I was playing that role, I had, like, just this bombardment of emails, just like,
imagine.
Yeah, just like, don't screw it up, just like, well, so I didn't feel that pressure until after I already did it, and by that point it was too late. It's just like, well, I hope I didn't.
When you were doing your panel, I think yesterday, a couple of fans have mentioned that you told a story about doing pranks. And
I do a lot of them, yeah.
Michael Tatum?
Yes.
Would you mind telling us about that?
Because sure.
I mean, I didn't hear it, but I heard that it was amazing, and I'm sure everyone else wants to hear it, too.
It's a bit of a long story, but it's worth it. So a few years ago, my brother and I were, we went to some event, like, close by to where Tatum used to live, and it's very rare that we got to see him at his place because he kind of lived far away from us, and so we were like, we should go see Tatum, we're in his neighborhood, and so I give him a call, and I'm like, hey, remind me where you live, we want to come over, and whatever, and left a voice message he didn't answer, and I was like, well, he's probably busy, he's probably not home, and my brother was like, actually, you know what, I think I remember where he lives, and so we went to his house and just wanted to, like, surprise him if he did happen to be there. And he wasn't. We knocked on the door, didn't answer. And we were just like, oh, that's too bad. And then my brother looks at his window on his porch. He doesn't live in the same place anymore, by the way. And he also swears that he locks everything now. But at the time, his front window was just open. My brother noticed that it was not locked. And he was like, oh, his window's unlocked. We should probably go in. And I was like, yeah. That sounds like a good idea. So we go in and we rearranged a bunch of his furniture. We put, like, post-it notes in some of his books. He has, like, a vast library of books. He's a big fan of reading. And so we, like, put, like, post-it notes of, like, ah, had a great time, thanks for the memories, in his books. And then, like, and then we started to leave because we were like, maybe somebody would have called the cops seeing someone go through someone's front window. And then as we were driving away, my brother was like, I really want to do more stuff. And I was like, I really do too. So we went to a 7-Eleven that was up the street, and we bought a bunch of stuff to put in his refrigerator, like little cans of beer, and then also his favorite ice cream, which is Blue Bell homemade vanilla, which I don't think you guys have here. But so I got him a little pint of that, and I tried to write I Heart Tatum on it, but because of the condensation on it, I basically just like carved it in it so it looked like a serial killer wrote I Heart Tatum. And so we did that, and it was just like we were satisfied, and then we left. And then he called, Tatum called me like maybe an hour after we left, and was just like, did you guys come by the house at all? And I was like, no, remember in the voicemail when I said we couldn't remember where you lived? And he was like, yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah, just some weird stuff happened. I was like, oh, that's terrible. You should get to the bottom of that. Bye. And I meant to call him back like 10 minutes later, just let him sweat it out. But I was watching Battlestar Galactica, and like, you know how that goes. So it was like 2 hours later, and I was like, might have even been longer. It was at least 2 hours, maybe three. I was like, oh, right, gotta call Tatum. So I call him back, and I was like, hey, did they put beer and ice cream in your refrigerator? And he was like, yes, oh my God, how did you know that? And I was like, they came to my house too. And he was like, oh my God, and just totally freaked out. And then I couldn't hold it anymore. And I was like, dude, I'm just messing with you. It was me and my brother. Me and Gino did it. And he was like, oh my God. And then proceeded to tell me how he had called every single person in his phone to try to figure out who it was. And not only that, also filed a police report.
Oh.
And so he had vowed to get me back ever since then.
Yeah.
And so we were doing our first convention together at Anime Central. I think it was like 2009. And so he had hinted that he was going to get me back at this convention. And so I did a preemptive strike. And at the opening ceremonies, you can find this on YouTube. At the opening ceremonies, I sang, because he's terrified of clowns.
Yeah.
I sang Stephen Sondheim's Send in the Clowns. And I rewrote all the lyrics to be about him and how when I broke into his house, I brought clowns with me, and that the clowns are still there and they watch him sleep and they're going to turn into one of them. And the best part of that is that he didn't actually get me back. So I just pranked him twice for no reason. And so I've been really wanting him to get me back ever since then. Because like at this point, I can't prank him again because then I'm just going to be a bully. So he has to prank me back so that I could also prank him back. But he knows that if he pranks me back, that I'm going to prank him again. So he's too afraid of me at this point. So it's probably not going to happen.
That's a pretty awesome prank. I would, that sounds pretty scary.
Yeah,
I've had friends walk into my house before and leave a cake on the table. But they actually made me a cake for my birthday. It was a BMO from Adventure Time cake. But in the car ride on the way there, it melted. So it had a creepy looking melted face.
It's like some mangled face.
I didn't realize that the door was open. So I come out of the shower and I'm just like, oh God, what's happening? And it was really scary. So I kind of see how it feel. And my friends, similar, they didn't tell me that they were there. So
it's
I was
like,
trying to figure out.
I don't know.
Wow. Yeah.
You're like, it's horrifying, just so you know.
What are some of the strangest things that fans have asked you to say? If you run into them on the street or trying to record your voice?
I mean, I don't really run into fans on the street a whole lot, unless they recognize me from TV stuff, which has rarely happened. But as far as like stuff that people ask me to say at conventions, I don't know. I mean, it's all fairly predictable. It's usually like typically something that character would say.
Yeah.
I think probably the weirdest thing that I get from fans, I'll get fan letters from people who are really big fans of The Walking Dead, and it'll be a really sweet letter that they will have sent to my agent or whatever, just like, oh, I just want to say I love your work, and I can't wait to see you more, you're so talented, and you were so charming, and blah, 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 and you know, they'll like put in, they'll have like a self-addressed stamped envelope for me to send back an autograph, and they're like, will you please autograph the enclosed photo? Thank you so much. Just like super polite. And then the photo is almost always a picture of my dead body on The Walking Dead. Spoiler, I die. Like a really brutal, gruesome, like it's actually a photo that's not even in the show, because like the shot that they did of that in the show is really far off.
Yeah.
So it's like a set shot of like the zombies like just like going at it on my corpse, which is like the weirdest thing to sign and be like, thanks for your support. Heart, Rena Valencia. Like, it's an odd thing. It's an odd fan base. I mean, I'm part of it. I adore The Walking Dead, but yeah.
And you've also voiced Shirayuki in Snow White with the red hair.
Yes, and I love how popular that show already is, and it's not even out on DVD yet.
Yeah.
I love that it's that popular.
It's really big over here. We stream it on our anime streaming platform called Anime Love.
That's great.
And it's right up there. Everyone loves it. But one of the things we were wondering is how you thought Snow White with the red hair sort of compares to other adaptations of Snow White.
Oh, it's very different. I think the coolest thing about the character of Shirayuki in general is I think she's such a strong female character. I think of any character that I've played, female character that I've played, she's probably the best role model. Mm-hmm. I love that it is a love story, but she doesn't lose sight of her own goals.
Yeah.
And she's still very focused on, she wants to be a court herbalist, and she works so hard toward that. And I think that her relationship with Zen is probably one of the healthiest representations of love that I've ever seen in media. I think it's so sweet, and they're so caring to one another and so supportive, and like, it's just such a beautiful story, and I'm so proud of it. Like, I really am so proud to be a part of that show. I truly am.
I think we're probably running out of time, so we might go to the giveaway. So what we're going to do is give away this copy of Evangelion 3.33 on Blu-ray.
Yeah!
Yeah! To win this, all you have to do is comment below with the code word NERV, and we'll give you a couple of minutes, so get posting, post NERV as many times as you want, and we'll answer some fan questions while we do that. So we have a question from Ebony Voigt. Are you enjoying Australia? So
yes.
Kyle Franklin asks, what did you think about your fairy tale character? How did you feel about them?
Juvia, to me, is like one of those like friends that you have where you're always just like, girl, you're so beautiful, you're so talented, you could do better. Like, I am rooting for Gruvia. At the same time, I'm like, come on, Gray, get your mind together. Look at this beautiful woman in front of you who would like do anything for you. But then at the same time, I'm like, Juvia, just walk away for a bit and then he'll miss you and then he'll know what he's missing. So I always am just like, girl, come on, get some self-worth. You got this. Like, you deserve better.
And then Elizabeth Leetie, thanks for doing an amazing job with Snow White. How do you feel about the storyline of season 2?
It's so exciting. I think it's just really sweet and awesome, and like, it really does go into the core herbalist stuff a lot, and there's actually a lot of adventure in it as well. I don't know, are you guys in season 2 right now?
Yeah, we're in season 2.
Excellent. Yeah, I think it's very exciting. I think it's just, I honestly can't say enough positive things about Snow White in general.
Yeah.
Like, it's just so beautiful. I love it.
Somebody up there said, how many characters have you voiced?
Somebody told me, I have no idea, but a fan told me at a convention I did a few weeks ago that it was 187. So,
wow.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
Yeah, somewhere around there.
And then we have Seba Homu. What are the difficulties of dubbing music compared to dialogue? Is it more or less difficult?
Let's see. Yeah, dubbing the music, it's a totally different skill set. For me, it's not any more difficult. I mean, if you're not a singer, obviously it's going to be a lot more difficult. I direct singers a lot, and I adapt a lot of the lyrics. I will say, to me, adapting lyrics is easier than writing scripts, but I have a lot of friends who are script writers who are like, nope, you do that, I don't want to do that. So to me, I just think, I'm a musician, so the singing and the adapting lyrics is really fun. But I know for other people, it's just not in their skill set, so to them it's a lot more difficult.
And what's your favorite line from playing CL?
My favorite line from CL would definitely be from season 1, a little bit of a spoiler, when he's confronted by his parents, and he says, I will never let go of my hatred.
I love that one. And we have a fan question that was previously submitted by Chris Wong, if you could make a dish or cocktail based on one of your characters, what would it be and why?
You know, Trina Nishimura actually made a cocktail for CL Phantom Hive at a bar that she used to work at in Dallas, and it was called The Phantom Hive, which is a dope name for a cocktail, right? And it was a Earl Grey-based cocktail, since he always drinks Earl Grey tea. So I don't think I could top that.
That's pretty amazing.
Because it was actually super delicious, too. I loved it.
And Farrah would like to know, what do you find more challenging to do, on-screen acting or voice acting?
They both kind of have their own skill set. I think in a lot of ways, voice acting can be more difficult because you can only rely on your voice to get an emotion across. So I mean, there are a lot of, like, one of the most difficult things is to get, you'll have one word that you get to say, and you have to portray all these different layers of emotion, whereas if when you're on camera, you can do it with your eyes, which is a lot easier. But I can also go into work in my pajamas if I'm voice acting, so that's pretty cool.
What kind of pajamas do you wear?
I've actually worn a kigurumi to work
before. Nice. Is it a themed one, an animal, or a character?
I own three. I have a bat one that I just got, which is super cute. He has a bow tie. I don't know why it's a him, even though I'm wearing it. I also have a dragon and a white tiger.
Wow.
I'm awesome. A huge fan of kigurumi. I love them. They're so comfortable.
Yeah, I was just going to say, they're so comfy. And if you could play anyone else in Fairy Tail, but not Juvia, who would you want to voice?
Oh, wow. I love Froche. I think Froche is the cutest thing to ever exist.
And we actually have a winner for the Evangelion DVD. So congratulations to Simon Hayward.
Yeah, Simon, congratulations. Hayward. And I'll personalize it to you.
Babe.
On camera.
And while you're signing that, I've got a question from Callum May, who wants to know, what's your favorite flavor of ice cream?
Ooh, good question. I like anything with a lot of chocolate, especially dark chocolate, and with like chocolate and peanut butter is one of my favorite combinations. But you know, sometimes I'm kind of a chocolate caramel kind of gal. Depends on my mood. But basically, you can't go wrong with chocolate.
Yeah,
is the lesson that you just learned.
Thank you. We'll be contacting you after the stream, Simon, asking for your contact details, but we've signed that and that will be mailed off to you shortly. Would you like to tell the fans where they can follow you on social media?
Oh yeah, definitely. That might be good. I am probably the most active on Instagram, which my Instagram is at Brinakins, Brinakins. I actually do like a lot of 15-second songs on there and stuff. Like, you can send me one-word suggestions and I'll make songs out of them. And I also am very active on Twitter, which is at Brina Palencia. So I have a Facebook too, but I'm not like super active on it.
And just one more question before we go. Erin Herman has asked, what inspiration helped create your Unogasai voice?
Honestly, I think that show is so well written. Because, you know, with a lot of the other crazy girl characters that I played, you kind of have to figure out a way to justify the crazy on your own. But that show is so well written that they gave her that backstory and, like, gave her all of that depth to where I didn't have to just create it in my imagination. So honestly, just the writing in and of itself is what inspired me the most.
Awesome.
I love that.
So do I. Thank you so much for joining us
with
this stream. And thank you for tuning in, everybody. And I really hope you enjoy the rest of Supernova today and the rest of your time in Australia.
Yeah, absolutely. If you guys are at the convention, please come see me. I'll be at my booth for the rest of the day.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thanks,
guys. Bye, everyone.